الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We are at chapter number 8, wiping over the khuff. What is the meaning of khuff? The khuff, this is something that's covered the foot, like salt, you see. Usually it's used from leather. But we'll give more explanation. This is just as an introduction. This, my dear brother, is one of the aspect of the easiness in Islam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this religion is very easy for us, and no burden on us. And this is, alhamdulillah, ni'mah. This is grace from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To show you that many people, they think that Islam is what? Is it difficult, give you a hardship, you know, cause you to do something which is, you know, beyond your ability. All these things, it's not true when you look how much, you know, Islam is easy in a way that Allah will not require the person to do more than what he can. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. So this is one of the aspects. So Islam is, the Sheikh said, the religion of easiness and simplicity, not difficulty and strictness. It decrees suitable ruling for each case. For each case, it has its own specialty. This is why, you know, when we talk about fatwa, what's the meaning of the fatwa? You know, some people, they think fatwa, that's to give answer for an Islamic question. But, or the ruling, or the general ruling, it's not like this. Fatwa, in fact, to give specific answer which fit a specific situation and case. Therefore, maybe the rule that which is good for one case, it is not the same will be for other case. So the answer will not be the same. This is why, my dear brothers, futya and fatwa, it's not an easy matter. No one should, you know, try to put himself in the position of giving fatwa unless he have a good knowledge of the deen and also give understanding, a deep understanding about what the ghayat, the objectives, na'am, al-ma'alat, what this rule will lead to, all these things. This is why it's not for anyone to give fatwa. We as a student of knowledge, we answer question. And this answer, in fact, it's not fatwa from ourselves. So any answer that I give sometimes when people ask me, it's not mine. But what I do, I try to find the answer and what? And the fatwa of the ulama, the scholars. So this is the point that I would like to, you know, point out here, because some people, they think that I give fatwa. I never give fatwa by my own, because it's not an easy task. And this is great responsibility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, giving fatwa, it's not for anyone. Transmitting fatwa, it's okay if the person understands. And generally, transmitting answer and not fatwa. And not fatwa. So we give general answer. And this is why sometimes when brothers, they ask me, I tell them, I'm not going to give you the answer now, maybe later, because I check. And sometimes I check with my sheikhs. Sometimes I send message to some ulama to give their response. So this is to show you that it is a matter which is very important. Decree suitable ruling for each case, which ensure fulfilling legal purposes and duties with no difficulty. This is what we talk about. Is the important thing is to meet the requirement and the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the same time, reach the purposes. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla, when He commands us to do something, there is objectives. Like for Siyam, Allah explained it. The purpose of Siyam is what? Taqwa. To attain taqwa. Not to feel hungry or feel thirsty or any of these things. Therefore, this taqwa could happen if the person intend to fast but he didn't because he can't, like the one who cannot fast and elderly people, maybe they give food, but did they meet the requirement? Yes, they did, for the best for their ability. This applies to ruling and ablushing, and we said we should not use the word ablushing but use the word wudu, decreed by Allah Azza wa Jalla. To illustrate, sometimes there is something covering the organs washed during ablution, which is hard to remove and may be needed as means of protection, either for the feet, such as khuff and the like socks, or for the head, such turban and utra and the like, or for protecting wound or the like, such as splints, bandages, etc. It is deemed permissible for the one performing ablution to just wipe over such covering instead of removing them and washing what is underneath. So here give you the general rule. It is generally allowed. We talk generally. But then we come to what? To the detail. Why? Because every rule, it has its own conditions, right? And should be done also in a certain way. Not just take it, yeah, it's allowed, and then you can do whatever you want. So this is why we need to have deep understanding. Unfortunately, now many Muslims, I notice, maybe if you go to the masjid, especially near markets, you find many people when they come to for the salah, alaykum salam, to the masjid, many of them, they take off their shoes and they take off their socks and then khudu. You notice this? Why? Because they have no knowledge of this rule. And some of them, they think it is bigger and getting more reward to take off his socks and make khudu. He said, no, this is washing. It's not like wiping. My dear brothers, the deen, it's not for us to see if it is bitter or not, if it is good or not. But it should be what? It should be based on the teaching, which is based on the dalil from the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the easiness made by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for permissibility of wiping over the khuf and their like, such as socks, during ablution, instead of removing them and washing underneath it, in fact, this is stated in many mutawatir sahih hadith. We have two words, mutawatir and sahih. And for those brothers who attended the class of science hadith, they know what does it mean, mutawatir and sahih. What is the meaning of mutawatir? Mutawatir.
Repeated.
Different sources. It was the hadith that was moved from one generation to another generation by more than one, many people, group of narrators in every stage or in every generation. This is called mutawatir. What's the opposite for mutawatir? Hadith? Ahad. Hadith? Ahad. So we have ahad and mutawatir. Hadith al-ahad is the hadith that was from the Prophet ﷺ, one person narrated this hadith. And it was narrated by the one who took it from this Sahabi, also one. That's mean in one stage or more, there only one. What is the famous hadith of Ahad?
Nah,
hadith Umar radiallahu anhu. You see how much this hadith is very important? How much is very important? That the ulama said this is consists half of the religion. Some of them they said half of the religion. Why? Because the religion based on two elements. Ikhlas and mutaba'ah. So al-ikhlas here in al-niyya, inna man amalu bil-niyyat. So this is also 50%. Naam? So you notice here that it is ikhlas here. طيب. So al-hadith al-ahad is one from another. Mutawatir which transmitted through group of narrators in every stage. طيب. Sahih. And we also explain the meaning of the hadith sahih. What is that sahih hadith? Huh? Hadith sahih. What is the hadith sahih? Ayah jatani. Huh? No. The meaning of hadith sahih. We have sahih.
Chain went back to
chain, okay. Chain of narrators, but everyone in this chain. The narrators should what?
They should have met and verified.
This is part of it. Ma yarwihi adlun dhabtun. Remember this? Adlun dhabtun. This is we took it. We didn't study this in the science of hadith.
This book. Be your sound character.
Na'am.
Strong memory. Strong character, strong memory.
Yes.
Have never to be well known.
No, just. This is what means of dhabt, adil. And just, adil, wa dhabt, with good memory. Barakallah. Naam? Right. Why the Sheikh mentioned this? He said, mutawatir sahih. Why? To confirm that this sunnah is proven. And no one should have any doubt about it. Why? Because of two reasons. First of all, because of the ignorance of many of the Muslim, they think it is, you know, they don't feel comfortable, you know, not to take off his sock when he makes wudu. Right? The other more important matter is because this is the way of the Shia, the Rafidah. The Rafidah, they don't use wiping over the socks. They don't follow this. So when we do it, in fact, we are doing what? We're following the Sunnah, the Prophet ﷺ, and differentiate ourselves from those Rafida or those deviated group. Right? The Prophet ﷺ used to wipe over them whether at home or in journey. The Prophet ﷺ enjoined doing the same. He commanded us to do the same. As regard the legal proofs of the permissibility of wiping over the khuf, Al-Hasan said, Naam, this referred to Al-Hasan whom? Hasan al-Basr. Hasan al-Basr, طيب, said, I was told by 70 of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he used to wipe over his khuf. 70 companions of the Prophet ﷺ reported this. That means what? It is common. The Prophet ﷺ is common to use, do this. Otherwise, not all these people will watch it and will record it. Moreover, An-Nawawi, Imam An-Nawawi said, the permissibility of wiping over the khuf was reported by innumerable companions. Al-Imam Ahmad also said, who was Ahmad? Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Said, there is not a shadow of doubt in my mind concerning the legality of wiping over the khuf. And there are 40 hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam indicating its permissibility. Ibn al-Mubarak, rahimahullah, said, and others stated that there was no disagreement among the companions concerning the permissibility of wiping over the khuf during ablution. All these reports to show that it is what? It is lawful and it is permissible. Ibn al-Mundhir, Who is Ibn al-Mundhir? When we talk, we mention who is Ibn al-Mundhir. What do we mean? Huh? Sheikh Abdul Majid, you know this. Always we mention the name of Ibn al-Mundhir. When? When we talk about? Huh? Al-Ijma'. Al-Ijma'. Because always, whenever they said Ibn al-Mundhir, because Ibn al-Mundhir, he wrote a book that he reported all the issues which was there ijma' among the ulama. What's the meaning of ijma'? Huh?
Consensus
of the ulama. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. Hayyak Allah. Fadal. Tayyib. Ibn al-Mundhir and others reported that scholars consensus of the permissibility of such an act during ablution. So it is a matter of ijma. So we have dalil from the acts of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have dalil reported by many of the sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also we have agreement among scholars of the Muslim about this matter. In addition, the adherent of the Sunnah and Muslim community unanimously agree on its permissibility, unlike those innovators in religion who do not deem it permissible. Referring to whom? Huh? Referring to the Rafida. Because the Rafida, they think or they believe that it is not permissible. Wiping over the khuffs during the ablution. This is an act is permitted and observing it is better than taking off the khuff and washing the feet. How come? Is it better to wash the foot without taking the khuff, or it is better to wipe over the khuff or the socks? Here it depends on the on the situation of the person. That means the Muslim should live and act in a normal way. That's mean, if he was, I don't know which one, if he was wearing his khuf or wearing his shoes or boot or socks, and he met the conditions of wiping over the sock, then it's better to follow the sunnah, not to take it off. Clear? But if he was not, he should not go and say, well, I'll wear the khuf or the socks, then I will wipe over it to follow the sunnah. So, which means that you should be according to the status that you have. If you are wearing the khuf, then it is better to follow the sunnah and wiping over the khuf. If it's not, you are not wearing anything, there's no need to go and wear it just to say that I will do the sunnah of wiping over the khuf. And this was the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he do it according to what? According to his, you know, the situation. طيب. It said here, this is an act permissible observing better than taking off, okay? As the former is a sign of making use of legal permission made by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. This also another issue, my dear brothers. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَن تُؤْتَى رُخَصُهُ كَمَا يُحِبُّ أَن تُؤْتَى عَزَائِمُهُ أو كما جاء في الحديث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. What does it mean? Allah Azza wa Jalla loves the person who take and act to the permission that was given to him by Allah Azza wa Jalla. Same way that Allah Azza wa Jalla loves the person who do his duties toward Allah Azza wa Jalla and act according to the command that was came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like for example, troubling, Allah Azza wa Jalla gave us permission for what? For shortening the prayer, right? In the journey. breaking the fast. Which is better here? It's better to take the permission. You know, this is another, there is more detail about this, but generally speaking. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla gave us permission that when you are wearing your shoes, you don't have to take off your socks. So why shouldn't take this gift, the permission that was given to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طيب. Following the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and contracting the religious innovators, wiping over the khuf is a spiritual removal of impurity underneath. Spiritual and not physical. Spiritual, not physical. Because we know now, when you wipe over the khuf, does this clean your foot? Physically. Does it clean it?
No.
Does it clean it? But this is a sign of what? A sign that you did or you respond to the command would show that you take the action that you may clean your foot. So it's a matter of spiritual. And always, my dear brothers, be careful to see the difference between spiritual and physical. As you remember, when we talk about impurity, we said that najasatu imma an takun najasatu hissiya aw ma'nawiya. Like for example, when we talk about the disbelievers, Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, إنما المشركون نجس المشركون نجس فلا يقرب المسجد الحرام. The disbelievers are impure, نجس. طيب. So some people they think نجس that means he's dirty or something. No, that's not physically here. Because this disbeliever, maybe she's your wife. Like if you are marrying a Christian or Jew woman, right or not? How come Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about her that they are najas, impure, and then allowed us to marry them? If it was, as we mentioned before, it's a matter of physical, that means we cannot touch or shake hands with one who is not. That's not true. Is it clear? So this is what they call it, spiritual. That means the najas, impurity in their heart, in their belief. The same thing for this matter. Here, cleaning, it's a matter of spiritual concept and not physical concept. Besides, if it was to clean the foot, how come we wipe over the khuf and not beneath it? If we are saying just for cleaning, then that means we should what? Wipe? From beneath, right? But here from up, why? Because it's a matter of spiritual and not physical. So as the Sheikh said here, it is removal of spiritual removal. طيب. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at this, this is very important. Never change the condition of his feet to perform ablution. This is the point that I want you to understand. The Prophet ﷺ never changed the condition. That means he acted according to the condition when the time for wudu comes. If he has socks or khuf, then he will what? Wipe over it. If he doesn't have it, what he do? He wash his feet. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If the Prophet ﷺ was wearing two khuf, he used to wipe over them, and if not, he used to wash his feet. Therefore, it is impermissible to put on khuf just before ablution in order to wipe over them while performing ablution. It's not just a matter, as we said, for this. طيب. Now we'll come to the conditions and the rules of this decree, which is related to the wiping of the khuf. Here we have conditions related to precondition and duration or the timing of the mask of the khuf. The duration of the validity of wiping over the khuf without taking them off. It is permissible for resident, not traveler, to keep wearing khuf and wipe over them during ablution for a period of one day and night. One day and night. Right? Does this mean 24 hours? Does it mean 24 hours? Right? Is it more or less? He said day and night. Less or more? I'm reading this question because I want, you know, to start thinking about this. We'll come to this. It's not exactly count by hours. Okay? But we'll see now, you know, how you count it. Maybe more, maybe less, depend on the action of the person. We'll talk about this. But here the general rule, as we mentioned. As for a traveler whose journey legally allows shortening prayer, because not every travel or journey will be considered as what? As traveler. But here when we talk in the Sharia, always, whenever it's come, the word traveler in the Sharia, in Islam, in the rules, it is the travel or the journey that you can shorten your prayer and break your fast, which is some ulama made it around 80 or 85 kilometers. And this issue has, you know, many argument or debatable issue among ulama. Some, they say it is not count by distance. By, like Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen and others, they said any journey that in the tradition, understanding of the people, consider as a journey, that person he take his luggage and everything, then it will be considered as traveling, no matter how long is the distance, less than 80 or more than 80. But generally here we talk always, whenever they give fatwa, they said more than 80 kilometers. This inshallah will come with us when we talk about certain the salah in more detail. So for this traveler, he's allowed, the period of permissibility is 3 days and night. ثَلَاثَةُ أَيَّامٍ بِلَيَالِيهِنْ 3 days and night. Also here it doesn't mean that it is 72 hours. According to the hadith of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that related by Imam Muslim, which stated that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam specified 3 days during which one can wipe over his khuf for a traveler, and one day and night for a resident. For both the resident and the traveler, the very permissibility of wiping over the khuf start. Now look now. Now count here to understand it's not a matter of hours. It starts from the time of being in state of ritual impurity, caused by respond to the call of nature, like passing urine or stool or wind, after wearing the khuf as a ritual impurity necessitate ablution for prayer. Still some scholars view that the duration begins from the first ablution after being in state of ritual impurity. Right. Here we have two views. Be careful. Two views. Some of them, they said, it's the start from the time that you wipe on the khuf for the first time. Let's say, for example, today in the morning, after you, before Salat al-Fajr, you make wudu. And after you make wudu, you put your khuf, your socks, for example. Clear? And then you are keeping your wudu. Just at 11 o'clock or before Salat al-Duhur, you respond to the call of nation. You use the toilet. Right? And then you make wudu. You make wudu and then wipe over the khuf during this wudu. So this is the first time that you wipe over the khuf. Right? So some ulama, they said, from this time, you count to the next day for the same time for the period. That means it's more than 24 hours, right or not? Because you start, for example, at 6 in the morning or at 5 in the morning and till 11, how many hours? 5 to 11, huh? 7? Huh? I'm not good in the 6 hours, and now you count about 24 hours, that means 30 hours.
Yes.
You got it? So this is one of the view. Other view, they said from the minute that you wear the socks, count. But this view, which is more sound. So again, if you make wudu, طيب, and then you wear, later you wear your socks while you are in the state of wudu and tahara, and then you stay with this tahara for 3 hours. Doesn't matter, 2, 3, maybe 8, 10, and then you respond to the call of nature from that minute, and then you renew your wudu, then you wipe over the khuff. Right? So this the sound view. Right? Maybe you just renew your wudu. You didn't use the toilet. And this is the other view. They say, for example, you wear your khuff after Salat al-Fajr. When it's come to Salat al-Duhur, at Duhur Salah, you didn't need to go to the toilet. But you said for yourself, I prefer to renew my wudu. So you renew your wudu and you wipe over the khuff for the first time. Clear? But when you wipe, in fact, you are not in need for this tahara. But it is a matter which is that you prefer. Because you didn't respond to the call of nature in any way. So some ulama, they said from that the first wiping after wearing the khuf. The other view, which I mentioned earlier, that after what? The first wiping after using the toilet or after you break your wudu. Is the picture clear? Huh? So two. Someone wipe over the khuf after renewing the wudu, and he still have wudu is valid, but he want to renew it. So some ulama, they said from that minute he count. Other they said no, this wiping will not be counted. Will not be counted. Why? Because it was not after using the toilet. Then later on when he used the toilet and then he renew the wudu, or we said do the wudu again, from that time will be count. And the last one, this one, which is more sound view. So in the future, just take this and remember this. If you wear your socks when you go to work, for example, طيب, put your shoes. If you are police or this soldiers, they have this long boot. Also, they can wipe over it, not only over the socks. Right? If the shoes cover the ankle, then also you can wipe over it. And the important thing that it's covered the area where wudu or ghusl, washing of the foot should take place. You can wipe over it. Right? So if you made this and you go to your work, no matter how long you stay, after you use the toilet, and then you make wudu, and then you wipe for the first time, then you can't from that time, till the next day, the same time. I hope it's clear. Right. Still, the conditions of wiping over the khuf. Now let's talk about the condition. To be in the state of ritual ritual purity. That's mean ala wudu. Ala wudu. That's mean when you wear it, it should be wear it on tahara. That means if you are not in the state of wudu and you wear this socks, then it's come for wudu, you cannot wipe over them. Clear? So the first condition is that before you wear these socks, if you want to wipe over them, it should be what? You should have wudu. طيب. Open wearing them, for it is stated. It is stated in the two Sahih. When we say two Sahih, we mean Al-Bukhari or Muslim and other books of Hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the one who wanted to help him in taking his khuffs off to perform ablution, leave them as I put them after performing ablution. دعهما فإني وضعتهما على طهارة وعلى وضوء كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this is the lead which is was reported in the two صحيح متفق عليه and many books of hadith like أصحاب السنن which one time you know the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم some of the Sahaba when he start to make wudu they run to serve them. So one of the Sahaba he was pouring the water. So the Prophet making wudu. So one of them, the Sahaba, when it's come to the foot, he want to take off the khuf from the Prophet. So he said, no, leave them. And he explained why. He said, when I put them after I had tahar. So from this, we learn that it is condition. Because he mentioned this. Don't take it because I put it in tahar. That means if it was not in tahara, then it is what? It is okay to take it off. It is also narrated that Safwan ibn Assal said, we are commanded by the Messenger of Allah, by the Prophet, to wipe over the khuf if we put them on while being in a state of ritual purity. That means after performing wudu. Thus, it is quite obvious that the ruling is dependent on being in state of ritual purity when putting the khuf on it. So, if one is in state of ritual impurity when putting them on, it is impermissible for one to wipe over them. This is very, very clear. So, the first condition we conclude that to be able to wipe over the khuf or the socks. Then, first of all, you should what? Wear them on tahar. So before you go to work in the morning, putting your shoes, first of all, make wudu, and then wear your socks. طيب. Second condition, the khuf must be lawfully acquired, cutting and made. Acquired, that means it was by halal, that means it was not stolen. Should not be made from something which is not lawful for to be wear, like what for men? Like silk. You know, this is not lawful for men. To clarify, if they are taken by force or made by silk for men, it is impermissible to wipe over them during ablution. In a word, legal permission is not applied to what is already illegal. We mentioned before at wudu, when you said the water should be what? Should be lawful water. طيب. Third condition, the khuf and their likes must completely cover the feet up to the ankles. This is a very important thing. If it was not shorter, like in some socks now, it is just cover part of that. This cannot be used. But it should cover the area where the legal wudu should take place. One cannot wipe over them unless they are thick enough and covering the parts of feet which are to be washed. You know, the matter of thick, this is a matter of area of, you know, a debatable issue among ulama. It should be thick, it should be thin. If there's holes in it, can we wipe or not? this is a matter of discussion among ulama. But here we'll follow what the Sheikh said here. So thus, if they are too short to cover the feet up to the ankle, or not thick enough to conceal underneath, it is impermissible to wipe over them. So this is what the Sheikh is mentioned here. As we said, another view that if it's not that much thick, then also it is accepted. Since it is permissible to wipe over the khuff, it is impermissible to wipe over any foot covering, such as socks made of wool or suckling materials which are thick enough to cover underneath. That is due to the fact that Prophet ﷺ wiped over his socks and his shoes while performing ablution. So the Prophet ﷺ, he used this way. Stated in the hadith related by Ahmad, Imam Ahmad, and other compilers of the hadith, deemed sahih, Imam al-Tirmidhi said, wiping over such things during ablution is valid until the legal period of permission ends, regardless of frequency of taking them off and putting them on. So it doesn't matter, as long as the person, he doesn't, you know, exceed the period which is allowed. As regard to the turban, now when we talk about the turban, it's not this one. The turban, if you know our brothers from Sudan, you know the Sudanese? When they have their turban?
Eight meters.
8 meters or more. You see, this takes them a long time, you know, to put it. Therefore, it is, alhamdulillah, it is hard to take it. If you take it and put it, then you need 15 minutes before the wudu and after the wudu to retain it back. So this is the what's mean by turban. But this one is easy. Just take it and you can get it back. And apply to this also what some ladies, hijab, they are having, if it was tied. Also, this is another area which is also allowed to wipe over. So it's not only for the socks, but over also on the turban or any cover of the tie. It's said here, two conditions. The first is that the turban must be covering the area of the head which is traditionally covered. That means should cover what? The ear. Why? Because the ear is part of the head. But maybe it's not covered, the ear. But the Sheikh said, what's known as usually people use to cover it with a turban. Most people, when they wear the turban, they cover at least from the beginning of the head till the beginning of the neck. And here, maybe it's come over the ears a little bit, or maybe cover the ears. If this is the case, then it is allowed to wipe over them. So this is one condition. The second condition is that the turban must be rubbed around the lower jaw up to the hip. This is the reason. Why? Because it's not easy to take it. One or more than one turn. Or to be with a back tail. You know, like some people, they put it, they say this is the sunnah. Okay, and they after they tie it, they put a little tie in the back. So this is what a traditional way that most Muslims they used to wear. And Muslim long time ago, they don't use what, you know, the way that we are dressing. Okay, and this is why, subhanallah, now if you go to many Muslim community in Africa, in India, in Indonesia, Malaysia, even here in Arabia, some Arab countries, and you go to the rural area, people who still having something from the past, you will know that they still have the same way. Like if you go to Egypt, in the south they call them Sa'ida, you know, the way is the same way like the Sudanese. If you go to Africa, like Nigeria, for example, also sometimes they use it, okay? You go to India, So everyone. So this is why the traditional way of the, what they call it, al-umama. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wiped over his turban during ablution. To illustrate, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said, he who is not purified by wiping over the turban, does not deem it sufficient for wiping over the head, then may Allah not purify him. So here Umar is giving you one more tough. Sometimes when he may try to make people, apply the Sunnah of the Prophet, he said, the one who thinks this will not purify me will never be purified. Why? Because he should follow the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi as-salatu was-salam. I think we should stop here. Abu Hadith will come. Yalla Abu Hadith. Now let's just finish this part. It's worth mentioning that it is permissible to wipe over the khuffs and turban only in case of purification from the state of minor ritual impurity, but not major ritual impurity. It's very important, my dear brothers. That means if the Muslim was he is in need for ghusl, like after janaba, can he wipe over the khuf? No. If the lady after she finishes her menses, can she wipe? No. So in a state of janaba, then you need what? To take off everything, because the meaning of the ghusl هو تعميم سائر البدن بالماء. This is the meaning of ghusl. Ghusl means that you cover the whole body with water. So if you have a khuf or turban, then you cannot cover it. And this is here just for the person, for example, if he has janaba. Before he sleep, it was recommended that if he doesn't want to make ghusl, at least to make what? To perform wudu. And this is the list. But if he was wearing a khuf, can he wipe now? No, he can't. So even he is allowed to make wudu, for the time, maybe he will make ghusl, maybe in the early morning, and he want to go to sleep, if he make ghusl, he cannot sleep, or because of the air condition, you see, it was recommended for him to make wudu. But he said, don't say, well, okay, I have my socks, so I wipe over them. Here it's not valid. Why? Because he is in a state of major impurity. So we stop here, inshallah, and we'll continue, inshallah, next week. Jazakumullah. Any question? Okay, no question. We have brother, welcome back, Abu Hudayfa. We missed you last week. He's giving Dars al-Sirah, was troubling last. Jazakumullah. Thank you.